we're going to be talking about the five things you need to know to get started with AppGyver in 2022. Here are the five things. Number one, how to get started with AppGyver fast. Number two, the best guides to build your AppGyver app. Number three, how to find the best AppGyver apps out there. Number four, the biggest changes coming to AppGyver. And number five, the best databases to use for your AppGyver app or project. To get started with AppGyver fast, what I would do is, first of all, write down what you're going to be using AppGyver for. When you get started with AppGyver, it's going to allow you to log in and get started, but it's also going to take you to a blank canvas of what you're going to do with your project. For example, I'm just going to say, okay, I want to do a beta app, and I'm going to create. Once I do that, it's going to give me basically a blank canvas to start at, and I'm going to have to add different components to build my app. This can allow you to feel frustrated or just feel overwhelmed when you're first getting started here. So I would back up and first decide what kind of app am I trying to create and why am I creating it? Am I doing it for my own project? Am I doing this for my own brand? Am I doing this so I can get a job in this field? And I should know a little bit about visual programming. Why am I going to be using this? I would write that down. And if you need help with this, make sure in the comment section down below, let me know what you're trying to do with AppGyver. From that point, it allows you to build with purpose your type of app that you want. What kind of components do you need? Do you just need AppGyver, or will you need other components along with this platform? Which goes into point number two, the best guides to learn how to build with AppGyver. We have a free notes of AppGyver that you can get for free. There's a link down below. You can sign up and it breaks it down how you're going to be able to use the components. What's the best way to start with AppGyver? And this allows you to have the screenshots and allows you to take your time of what kind of app you're trying to create. This entire section is broken down from what we learned from the tutorial section for AppGyver. So if you've gone through the onboarding of AppGyver, but maybe you missed certain steps, that's what our notes are based off of. So you know the intricate details of what you're going to be doing as you're creating your automations or how you're going to be building out AppGyver visually. To find inspiration, you can be looking at the Creator Spotlight. They do this almost every single week, and you're going to be able to be exposed to different types of apps and see the capacity of what is possible with AppGyver. It gives you some details on the creators, where they're posting their app, why they're doing it, the inspiration behind the app. And for me, it allows me to see what kind of components are they using in their app. Why did they choose that? How did they build the app? Those things are considered in the articles, but also because you have access to who created it, of course you can reach out to them. And I would just also say a lot of them, creators give their time, but they're also busy because they're building their app or they're doing other things. So if I'm going to be reaching out to different creators, I'm also going to offer to pay them to talk to them about their app. I'm not just going to be like, hey, tell me, can I copy your ideas, or can I just, you know, can you teach me for free? I would first respect their time, talk to them, let them know where are they in their business, are they offering such services, and go from there. And if they're not, at least being able to have the creator spotlight to gain inspiration and understand what you're going to be able to do with AppGyver or how you're going to plan out to achieve something similar to them, that allows you to have a roadmap of what's possible and what you want to do for your app. In the comment section down below, let me know what kind of apps you're trying to create. Is there a very specific app that you have seen in the spotlight that you have questions on? Or are you just looking at what's possible with AppGyver? Let me know in the comment section down below. Number four, let's talk about the changes that are coming to AppGyver. Now, this was announced in mid-2021, but now if you're new to AppGyver, maybe you've seen my past tutorials and you're like, wait, I can't do certain things anymore. What's up? AppGyver has discontinued a number of their services for the future. That includes the cloud database, the AppGyver authentication, and AppGyver managed file uploads. Simply put, If you're doing anything with a database or anything in the back end, you're not going to be able to do it like you used to with AppGyver. This is discontinued on August 31st, 2021. So going forward, if you're looking at old tutorials about AppGyver where we're talking about how you use their database, it's just not available anymore. What does that mean for your pricing and budget and all those things? For the most part, if you're going to be using a third-party database, it's going to cost some amount of money. Now, you could be going with Google Firebase and others, depending on the tier level. Maybe it will be free, like Xano starts with a free level, but this really depends on the type of app you're trying to create and the amount of data or rows that you're going to be needing for your project. If this is brand new to you and those terms might be like, I do not understand that at all, Doc, let us know in the comment section down below what kind of app you're trying to create, and we can give you some kind of details or help to determine which level you're going to create. Bottom line, if you're trying to create a minimal viable product, you're probably not going to be taking up a lot of rows of data versus if you've already got an established brand, you're already getting a lot of users, they're using it with a lot of messaging or uploading, then you're going to be needing to pay for a service where you're going to be having a lot to account for. To get more details of what this is going to be, we're going to have a link down below to this article of all of the different services that will be discontinued and what this means for your project. Let's look at a couple options for your database if you're going to be needing to store data. And for the vast majority of your apps that you're going to be using, you're going to need some kind of database because that allows your app to be smart. It's going to remember a certain amount of information, and you're going to want to recall that information, so you're going to need a database. Let's take a look at two right now. Number one, Xano is an option where it allows you to build a powerful, scalable, and secure backend for your app using no code. This is really important where it talks about secure, because if you're going to be doing something that requires using medical records or doing something where it's privacy related, this is going to be an excellent option for you. If you look at the pricing structure, to begin with, at the build level, which is free, you're going to have up to 1,000 total records for free. And then if you're going to go beyond that, it starts at $59 a month. If you're going to go to another option like Firebase from Google, this also allows you to have a generous starting point for your different types of database that you're going to construct. I would mention before I even go into more of the pricing with Firebase, because it's very competitive with the pricing, which is great for us, it does take more work to set up Firebase if you're not used to coding or dealing with more technical aspects. Xano is friendly for no coders. So when you're getting started, it is very straightforward. They make it very easy. Firebase, on the other hand, is made for developers, made for you to build on their platform, but it does have a leaning for developers. So when you're getting started, if you look at the pricing, it's actually pretty cheap if you're looking at this. Let's see, authentication, looking up to $10,000 per month, the cloud fire storage. Okay, it depends on what we're doing, but it's still on the free level. Storage up to 10 gigs, okay. And that's all on the free side. If we go pay as we go, you can see it's still pretty cheap. You know, we're looking at the pricing, depending on what you're doing, those pricings are still pretty good, right? A couple cents, depending on what we're doing. So that's another option. If you're not familiar with Google Firebase, you're going to have to watch tutorials or learn more. But again, it's pretty competitive and you can start on the free tier as well. There are tons of other options you can be using for the databases. What I would focus on, I would back up, first decide what kind of app you're trying to create, go through all of the four steps before you get here with the database options, and then determine which one would be best for you and why. Are you on a very tight budget? Do you need certain functionality of your database? Do you need to have security and you need that for your client or for yourself? All of those things need to be considered before you just pick the cheapest option, or someone says, hey, I use this, go with that. You have to consider them and then go with the best option for you. In the comment section down below, let us know what you're trying to build and why. And if you like these kind of videos, we put them out every single week, so make sure that you like and subscribe. We'll see you in the next video.